Yo, what's good YouTube? It's your boy Savory Reacts, and I'm back with another video. So, for today, actually, before I even say what we're reacting to, y'all peep the merch. It's a prototype. It's not like, I'm gonna, like, put it on a website or something for you guys to get. I don't know. I don't know if I'm, like, that big, on YouTube yet to, like, have merch or anything. But maybe later on down the line, I might have merch that looks kind of like this, maybe a little different. But yeah, it looks nice. I got it for Christmas, but like I forgot to wear it in my past reactions. But I just remembered, and I'm actually glad I'm wearing it in this reaction, because actually, looking at it now, it's pretty fire. But yeah, let's say what we're reacting to today. Going to the channel The Game Theorist, and this video is called Game Theory, Spider-Man Destroyed New York, Spider-Man Miles Morales. Sadly, I don't have the PS5. Not because I didn't get it, but because I don't really play video games like that, so there's really no point in me getting the PS5. I forget how much it costs. I think 500, correct me if I'm wrong, but yeah, there's really no point, to be honest. Yeah, but I'm wondering what this is about, because I've watched gameplay. Who did I watch play it? I forgot who I watched play it, but I watched the whole story mode for this game, Spider-Man Miles Morales, and it was actually pretty good. The whole reason, like, I wanted the PS4 and PS5, because the PS4 had the other Spider-Man game, is because of the Spider-Man games, because that's my favorite superhero, or my second favorite, because my first favorite is Deadpool, and then my second favorite is Spider-Man. But yeah, guys, before we get into this video, make sure you like, comment, subscribe.
Oh, brother, this guy stinks!
Turn that post notification button so you get notified every time I post a video. And let's get right into this reaction, man. Let's go.
Game theory, doing science till you're weary. Ranking heroes using math. Angry commenters and their wrath. Watch out, here comes the game theory.
Okay. Like the intro.
Hello, internet. Welcome to Game Theory, right. The show that looks good in tights. Today, our focus is on Spider-Man, specifically Miles Morales. Probably should clarify that now that there are two Spider-Men in town. Well, actually, just the one, since Peter Parker has taken a well-earned vacay, but still.
Mm-hmm. MJ's headed overseas for the Bugle.
He looks...
trusted me as her photographer. Kind of a working vacation for us. So let's not let Peter...
For some reason, they changed the way Spider-Man looked, because in the other game, he looked different. He looks way younger in this. It's like, is he supposed to be like modeled after like Tom Holland or something? Like, I don't know, it just looks weird.
Distract us here. We've got much more interesting things to talk about today, because with a new Spider-Man comes new powers, and with new powers comes new responsibility. You see, Spider-Man Miles Morales just came out, and as upgrade 2.0 of the original Spider-Man, it's got itself some feature bloat. In addition to your standard issue spider skills, Miles has camouflage ability and bioelectricity. Now, don't get me started on this. Maybe get me started a little on this, because what the? First, the camouflage. Great, you got yourself special DNA powers from a spider bite that make you invisible. Cool. Totally fine.
I mean, it's in the comics.
But why are your clothes that's not like able random. To change too? These are DNA based powers. I'm not asking for streaker.
I didn't even peep that. Town.
I'm just saying that your DNA magic should not be able to cloak your literal cloak. Gripe number two. Your bioelectricity is called Venom Strikes.
I didn't even notice that.
That's not gonna get confusing with another character in this franchise. Digression over. Thank you for letting me get that off my chest. Anyway, thanks to Miles's electrocharged venom powers, Miles succeeds in a battle against Rhino where Peter fails. It's enough to make Pete realize that he's quickly becoming obsolete.
Bioelectricity. Wow. Gotta be honest. little jealous.
Now, of course, these electrical abilities are useful during combat, but
he
me,
went
there's
off
something
on
much
Rhino.
More interesting about him. Throughout the game,
that was
Miles
a good fight.
Is forced to use his body like a capacitor, aka a device that stores up electrical energy. Sometimes he's sucking the power out of security systems to shut him down or get past electrified barriers. Sometimes he's powering things up like a battery on two legs with excellent taste in music. But without question, the most impressive feat we see Miles accomplish comes at the end. So, spoiler warning, because it's kind of impossible to actually talk about the game's big climactic scene without, you know, saying everything that happens during
his
that
friend
scene.
Does.
So, the final mission of the game, the Battle for Harlem, features the climactic showdown between our two opposing forces. In this corner is Roxxon, a megacorporation that's promising to deliver high-efficiency power to all of Harlem with their innovative new fuel source called Nuform.
What you're standing next to... is a new form.
But it comes with a catch.
No points for guessing that new form is actually dangerous.
No one's gonna care about a few sick people uptown or a dead engineer.
Prolonged exposure to it can result in health defects like bone marrow decay. And in our other corner is the high-tech terrorist group known as the Underground. Vigilantes that are trying to expose Roxxon's evil business practices. If you're wondering why the Underground is one of the bad guy factions here, well, their way of sending a message about the dangers of Roxxon isn't by... you know, whistleblowing or contacting the news or anything like that, but rather by blowing up a reactor which will actually cause an explosion that destroys all of Harlem.
So they're both bad. Pretty much.
You're gonna vaporize all
Cause that was an awful
After a
idea.
Battle against the Underground's leader, the Tinkerer, Miles finally makes his way to the reactor. And in the same way that we've seen him drain the power of electrical devices across the city, Miles draws the power from the reactor. But of course, that is a lot of energy, and Miles, as a human capacitor, has to do something with it all.
Get them far away. I can't hold this in much longer.
Luckily, the head of the Underground has a last-minute change of heart and decides to help Miles out by grabbing him and flying high above the city, so that when he releases the massive explosive discharge of
energy... I'm just confused, like, why didn't she, like, drop? Well, why'd she stay up there and decide to die? Like, what?
Nothing and nobody is close enough to get hurt. In the end, Miles survives so he can return for the sequel. Harlem is saved, and the Tinkerer has a heroic final sacrifice. But because we never see the body, she can always return in the sequel if they feel like it. That final cutscene is, quite frankly, an awesome display of power, bravery, and self-sacrifice. It's also completely useless. Oh, sure, it may look all heroic, but Miles Morales completely fails to protect the city in this moment. Miles completely botches the rescue of New York City. And kills millions, but to understand why, we first need to look a bit closer.
We kill millions? What?
At the start of the game, we see a big presentation from Roxxon's head of R&D, Simon Krieger. As we find out, this reactor runs on a fictional fuel source.
Nobody died.
Nuform.
Just one canister of this revolutionary fuel source is enough to supply Harlem with clean, safe energy for the next 500 years.
Of course, Nuform is actually making people sick, meaning it's a threat to everyone in Harlem, to which I say, why would you not build the power plant somewhere else? Like, I don't know, middle of the desert? That is literally what's done with tons of other real-world power plants. Guess what? The existence of power grids make it so that the power plant that supplies energy to all of Harlem doesn't actually have to be in Harlem. In fact, tons of people in New York City have their homes powered by electricity that's generated by Niagara Falls, which is like 400 miles away. You can even maintain it using the robotic help that we know exists in the Marvel Universe, or heck, just use some of the holograms that we see throughout the game. Roxxon's plan to build their sickness-causing power plant in the middle of a population center is not just evil, but let's get real, it's just bad business. Seriously, have you looked at real estate prices for New York City? A moderately sized commercial building is going to cost you nearly $1 billion. Billion with a B, dollars. Maybe it's time I just quit YouTube and become the accountant for an evil corporation. Probably save them a bunch of money. Does Amazon have any openings? Since a single canister of Nuform has enough energy to power Harlem for 500 years, all we need to know is how much energy Harlem consumes in a year and then multiply it by 500. Luckily, we have ourselves a handy tool for calculating this exact number.
Math.
Thanks to Vijay Mahdi, a professor of mechanical engineering at Columbia University. This map shows the estimated annual energy consumption of New York City on a granular block-by-block basis. Totaling up all of Harlem gives us a total of, let's see, carry the one, 91,000. 1,860 megawatt hours per year. That means that if a single canister of Nuform has enough energy to power Harlem for 500 years, it is packing a total of 45.93 million megawatt hours. Or,
oh, wow.
To put that in SI units, which will make it easier for our calculations later, 165.3 million
dang.
Gigajoules. Why are you not impressed? Oh, I know, because those numbers are meaningless. I've been doing this for a decade, and I still can't automatically see megawatt hours or gigajoules and know whether that's a really impressive number or not. So to put those numbers in perspective, the amount of energy that Miles is absorbing from the reactor is approximately 95% the amount of energy from the sun that hits the Earth in one second.
What?
Or five times as much as all the nuclear power plants on Earth generate every single day.
Oh, and he didn't get high enough then?
625 times as much energy as was unleashed by the atomic bomb that was dropped on Hiroshima during World War II.
So people did get affected then.
And that is just the energy in a single canister of the stuff. At the end of the game, we're told that Miles has to stop the reactor because if it blows up, the resulting explosion would destroy all of Harlem.
You're not just gonna destroy Roxxon Plaza. You're gonna vaporize all of Harlem.
But boy, this would go way beyond just destroying Harlem. The most powerful nuclear weapon ever tested was the Tsar Bomba, which was created by the USSR during the Cold War. It had an explosive yield of around 243 million gigajoules. And, well, take a look at the mushroom cloud yourself. That picture was taken at a distance of 100 miles or 161 kilometers
whoa.
Away. And you can still see the cloud, which itself is 40 miles or 65 kilometers high. Now, what's notable is that this bomb was actually detonated at an elevation of 2.5 miles or 4 kilometers above the ground, and it still left a massive crater below it. Not only that, but structures over 500 miles away from ground zero were still hit by the after effects of the explosion. To put that in perspective, if you detonated that same explosive yield over Harlem, people as far as North Carolina would be feeling it. Heck, people in Canada would be feeling it. Tsar Bomba actually created a seismic wave in the Earth's crust that circled the
ground. Wow, that's pretty
three separate times before it finally dissipated. Now, Miles's discharge, ugh, that sounds gross, his electrical explosion isn't quite as powerful as Tsar Bomba. His yield is only 68% as powerful as, you know, the most powerful nuclear weapon to ever be tested on Earth. But it does raise an important point here.
It's still pretty powerful,
though.
The
Tinkerer's simple plan of flying miles above the Harlem city block to insulate the city from the effects of the explosion isn't the magical cure-all that you'd be hoping for. So, how bad is the damage we're talking about here? Well, in that final scene, we see the Tinkerer running up the side of a building, only to hold Miles just slightly above the cloud line. The tallest building in Harlem is the Harlem River Park Towers 1 and 2, standing at around 428 feet or 130 meters tall. Not super high. So that's our initial launch point. And from there are technically three layers of clouds, low, middle, and high clouds. The lowest layer caps off at 6,500 feet or 2,000 meters. And considering her launch point is significantly lower than that, we're going to say that this is absolutely the highest height that
that's
the Tinkerer
still pretty
is
close.
Able to get. Using this website, nuclearsecrecy.com, we can actually see what happens when you detonate a 34,000 kiloton bomb 6,500 feet over New York City. So did Miles manage to save Harlem? Let's find out in 3, 2, 1,
just say no.
Nope. Big nope. Basically, all of Harlem is vaporized as it falls within what's called the fireball zone. The rest of central New York City is in the heavy blast damage zone, where heavy concrete buildings are severely damaged or demolished, and fatalities approach 100%. Goodbye Central Park, goodbye Times Square, goodbye Broadway. Well, there wasn't really anything happening.
Wait, that much
this year.
Would be
Hamilton
affected?
Disney Plus, so really, that one wasn't too much of a loss. The entire rest of the city
was still closed,
as well as all
but I thought he was like
pretty solidly into the moderate
good
damage zone.
Distance away for him to explode.
And fatalities are widespread. My conservative estimate looking at this data is that 4 million people die in the resulting explosion. So it was a nice thought, Tinkerer, but you really didn't
oh,
make
wow.
that much of a difference. But fortunately, our friendly neighborhood Spider-Man survives in the apocalyptic fallout. And the fact that he was able to absorb all of this energy into his body is a serious testament to his capabilities as a superhero. I mean, it's not quite MCU's Thor power, allowing the entire energy of a star to pass through his body, but he's doing pretty darn good. To give some context, a lightning strike has the power of about 10 gigawatts. So what Miles is experiencing is the equivalent of getting struck by 1,180,000 lightning bolts simultaneously. So you know what? I think I take back what I said. Maybe Miles is actually a better match for Thor, the God of Thunder, than I thought. And yet, New York is apparently still full of street criminals who think they can go toe-to-toe with Miles using nothing but their fists. Maybe that's the most unbelievable part of this game.
Like, why are they even bother to fight him? Of New York.
Hard to be a friendly neighborhood Spider-Man.
I mean, it
Spider-Man
is a video game,
just
so
accidentally nuked the neighborhood.
They have to fight,
but
even though they're gonna get messed
it's
up.
It's episodes like today's that make me really thankful for...
But yeah, guys, that is it. Yeah, that was an interesting theory. I thought he was, Miles was a good distance away, but apparently he wasn't, which is interesting. But it is just a video game, so, like, I don't think, like, people, like, pay attention that much, except for channels like The Game Theorists that break everything down for everybody, and, like theorize if like more people died from this explosion. But yeah, he went into it with all the numbers and the megajoules and the bombs and the sun or whatever he said. But yeah, that was very interesting. But yeah, guys, that'll be the end of the video. Make sure you like, comment, subscribe, and turn that post notification button so you get notified every time I post a video. And I'm gonna be out.